not everybody may have a plan, right?
Was that all a plan?
Mr. Sutton, you send me more email than my husband. You said you have an idea for a compromise. Let's hear that. Let's indulge a minute and hear that. We're all just among friends on the record with the LA Times listening, so let's have a discussion.
This is on the Econ Tax issue where there did seem to be a, you know, disagreement with some of the commissioners and some and I just have this idea that it could be something where maybe you could get three or four commissioners to vote on. So kind of in lieu of the current proposal, which is the title of every city employer officer and the date of every contact, in lieu of that, having the divisions or departments, or whatever that word is. And I think that's kind of important. Sometimes they're divisions, sometimes they're departments, but have it part of the pull-down menu, except for general managers and above. So general managers, commissioners, elected officials would be done by title and not having dates. So I think you satisfy the staff's concern about when is it maybe, when's the project maybe at the lower level staff, and then when does it hit higher level staff, but not the date, so you satisfy a lot of the concerns about the difficulty of gathering information, but then also the your concern, Commissioner, about the higher level, then the public has a right to know kind of who that is.
So the dates, though, it seems to me if you have to write down who you're talking to and what it's about, that probably just writing like 10/17 isn't that
absolutely wrong. Absolutely, because it's you might. It tends to be if you get the opportunity to talk to a commissioner, a general manager, or an elected official, there's going to be one time. But when you're talking to the lower level staff, that could literally happen every day, and there could be emails and then the follow up emails. So that's really where it's a complete trap for the inquiry.
So it's your feeling that the date is far more burdensome than the title, division, agency aspect of the increase.
Well, the title, to be very honest, I just think is completely unworkable because no one knows what anyone's job title is. So, but no, the date is clearly, yes. And it's all about trade-offs, right? It's all about, yeah.
So I'm very open to including division, department, and, you know, going back to what Mr. Harvey was saying before, and what you're saying, Mr. Sutton, that when the conversation with a director or above is happening, then a date is recorded, because as you said, like, that's maybe, you know, that's when the elected official is calling you back. That's when, right, that's more easy to capture. So that does feel much more comfortable. I wonder though, okay, so maybe you're talking to somebody on an everyday basis. How do we capture?
I really do want to reiterate, I can't overstate how it will be difficult, if not impossible, to track dates. And in the jurisdictions which have dates, it is a complete trap for the unwary. And what has happened is, in San Francisco, your legislative opponent, your political opponent, does a Public Records Act request, gets all the emails between an organization and different offices, and then sends those emails in, and always, even for the lobbying entities that are trying to comply with the law, they miss it. And then you have an open enforcement matter, and maybe a fine, maybe not a fine, and all that is balanced against how important is that information to the public, the difference between meeting on January 1st versus January 15th, right? As opposed, again, it's all, I think, about trade-offs and balancing and
Mr. Tarzi, would it would it make sense instead of putting something like a date, let's say that is an impossible request, of putting like the number of times or number of interactions, like a, having a range of interactions, would that?
I am aware of at least one other jurisdiction that does require that. I believe City of San Jose, or San Jose does require that, a total number. With regard to the comment about nickel and diming, you know, finding one missing piece and going after them, you as commissioners have seen through our enforcement actions, that's not what occurs. It's usually, we've had about 3 failure to registrations, I think 4 incorrectly or missing disclosure pieces, and all those are tens of thousands of dollars of missing disclosures, not one piece of information. That's the kind of information that you typically know.
But so capturing a date, if it's, let's say there's one particular issue, right, that there's the Greek Theater or something like that, somebody's working on this issue, right, it's gonna, and so you're talking on a daily basis, and maybe there's a way to bucket, you know, that someone had 1 to 5 communications, 5 to 10 communications, 15 or above, and that fills the note, like that lets the public know, wow, this is a hot issue item. You know, this is happening, this is moving, versus like, I don't know that knowing a day actually tells me anything, but actually aggregating the number of times that an interaction occurred actually is more informative, at least from my perspective.
No, and I understand that. Let me just say, I do recall, I think it was a written public comment we received where it is important, knowing the date, especially when you're considering something coming before a public meeting, you can kind of see the flurry of activity occurring before either a commission meeting or a council meeting or some decision like that. I don't know if you are considering, you know, just having a certain number of or a certain level of individual reported. If that would be the case, I would assume it would match the division and the department, so division head, department head, not just a general manager.
Sure. And if we're reporting on a bi-monthly basis, then having a number of interactions prior to something happening again should seem to satisfy that piece of information.
But it seems to me even in that situation, you're working from some raw material, and the raw material is best as you could each day, writing down who you met with, what time, and all of that, and each day. Then reporting it, now you've got to synthesize what you've been reporting rather than just transferring the information across into the report.
Correct. The concern is keeping track. You're still keeping track.
Well, you're double keeping track. Now you're aggregating it rather than just repeating it.
And I would agree that in San Diego, which requires a number of contacts, frankly, Commissioner Oberstein, that's really just burdensome because you have to have the backup documentation for that. But if I can just make 2 points, I thought your question about is it the Ethics Commission's responsibility to give information to the public tracking the project, and I kind of think that is more, if I'm a member of the public, I'm going to go to that department for that information. And the other thing, the comments made that we don't want to duplicate information that's provided other places. Well, you can always do a public records act request, or if someone wanted to track the lobbyist association's interactions with the Ethics Commission about municipal lobbying ordinance, they have the correspondence file from that particular agency. Now, it's not perfect, right? Nothing's perfect. But there are other places where the public can go to track kind of how busy it is. And I think also the number of contacts, yes, that would give the public information, but it's a trade-off, and that is just an incredible burden. It's a trap for the unwary. I've now written down what Mr. Tardy said about the enforcement, and I'm gonna use it next time Mr. Perez calls on behalf of the client, because we all know that is fine and dandy to say in the past they've only done certain things, but if the law requires you to disclose a number of contacts, that's kind of no guarantee. I think it's about trade-offs, and I think you have to kind of reach a compromise on this. And the idea of the titles when it's a high-level person, just the divisions or the departments when it's a low-level person, and the 2-month reporting is going to give the public a lot more information than they have now.
All right, thank you. All right. When we break for lunch, I think we were in some ways wrapping up tabling our 501c3 exemption discussion. I would suggest that we talk about the private attorney general addition. I think there may be some consensus among the commission that this is a part of the provision that, or part of the proposal that perhaps we could drop, but I may be wrong. I heard a number of, I am worried about the potential for abuse and retaliation. And I think we have very robust enforcement, and I have a lot of trust in our enforcement agency, our enforcement division, excuse me. So, with that,
yes, I think especially if we do pass something which I think is an improvement and a robust lobbying requirements and it's upheld or passed on by the city council, I think we do have a very strong system and one that should ferret out things that should be ferreted out and not pay any attention to the small stuff. So I feel pretty, I really feel good about that. Since 1967, I have had my name on various private attorney general provisions, or asking for class actions as far back as in the Vasquez case in the 60s, and then I was in the state attorney general's office. So I do believe it's an excellent tool. It's a tool that I have advocated for many different places. But I heard loud and clear this concern from the nonprofits about chilling effect and the fact that it could be used in a retaliatory way. And also from the private industry as well, that they are concerned that, that it would be used, as occasionally it has been used in the past, without good faith. I don't think that's a big problem, but I think I could put my money where my mouth is and say, since it's not really a big problem, and since we have a very strong enforcement system, if we get it passed, I could say we could leave the private attorney general for another day and to see that it needs to be done when it needs to be done, and we see a true need. So I would be comfortable, but what gives me that comfort, quite frankly, is the fact that the staff has come up with what I think is a good proposal. And it isn't perfect either in terms of giving out knowledge, as I've mentioned. We still have a little slippage there in those project definitions.
Yeah, if I may just add a little context, as we can really get into this in the August meeting. You're correct, our enforcement team, they do their work great. And just to clarify a comment, because sometimes we hear what we want to hear, those lobbying enforcement actions were ones that came before the commission, right? You talk about every single thing you've ever done with lobbying. With regard to the private attorney general provision, the reason why staff proposes to be inputted into the regulation, the voters of Los Angeles required this when it comes to the campaign finance ordinance, campaign finance requirements in the city charter. And because of that, previous ethics commissions have included that in the governmental ethics ordinance and have included that in the campaign finance ordinance, all through bodies of law under the ethics commission to ensure consistency, to apply the same level of gravity and the same enforcement capabilities across our laws to ensure that very important consistency. That is why we recommended that this be included.
Absolutely, and I think I would have done exactly the same had I been staff. I would have.
And just add a little more clarification to your earlier point. We did look into private attorney general actions that have arisen from the provisions that are already in place, and we've only discovered two in those three bodies of law. So there hasn't been this cottage industry that some are professing it will occur. at least with the other three bodies of law.
All right. Could I ask to hear from Commissioners Overstein and Murray on the private attorney general?
I have been looking over this provision for several times, and I always look at it and I look away and look at it again to have fresh eyes, and I still don't see. I understand your logic as far as consistency, but I just don't see the purpose of it. I don't think that at this time, as Commissioner Gordon said, I don't think that it's necessary, and we already have so many things that we're dealing with that meet so many issues. I don't want to add another thing that is not absolutely necessary. There's not a purpose, I feel, that it would be served. And I am, especially in today's political climate, I don't want another tool that can be used or abused. So.
Okay. Well, allow me to try and sum up where we are. I believe that there was consensus on the reporting period. Every 3 months and the filing deadline
every two months.
I believe there's consensus that my ophthalmologist is absolutely right, that I should wear these more often. I have more pairs of glasses than I do shoes, in fact. The direct communications, I think maybe we should revisit right now this potential compromise dealing with kind of just listing division or department for low level employees and then listing more for general managers and above. I don't know that I felt any consensus one way or the other on not including dates. And this is probably because the only time that I did timesheets was as a lawyer where we had to mark everything date by date, but I always had to write down the dates.
I think all timesheets have dates.
Okay.
And timesheets have a lot of information. And usually the offices that run well have all kinds of remedies for the timesheets that don't come in the same day. And if they don't come in the same day, certainly by the end of the week. And those remedies were never happy, at least in my personal experience.
So that was my personal experience as well. So I think we should have this discussion about the direct communications. As with respect to the 501c3 exemption, I think we're at the place where Commissioner Gordon and I are comfortable, and I'm not sure if those to the physical right, but ideological left of us. I'm joking, of course, are, and I think there's consensus with respect to the private attorney general. So let's not talk about the reporting period and the filing deadline. Let's talk about direct communication, and let's not talk about the private attorney general again. Let's talk about direct communications first, and then the 501c3 exemption.
I just wanted to clarify, and I know I asked you this earlier, but that the communications that we're talking about are not the, you know, snack bar. I keep using that as it's kind of getting a tired sort of example, but we're not talking about, hey buddy, I'll see you, oh, you know, how about those daughters? Oh yeah, by the way, that you see in the elevator. I just want to clarify that those are not the communications that you're talking about.
You're absolutely correct.
Okay.
That's not the information we're looking for. We are looking for meetings, one-on-one
okay.
meetings with staff, you know, that's primarily what we're looking for. It's not the hi-bye.
But you could have an impromptu meeting where you say, hi, oh, and by the way, I just want to tell you, I think this is a really great project.
If there's a high buy, but it turns into a 25-minute conversation about a project.
What if it's 4 minutes?
1 minute.
Yeah, exactly.
And you're gonna bill for 4 minutes?
If you're billing for that 4 minutes, for example.
If you're billing at 10-minute increments?
Most lobbyists don't bill their time. I hate to interrupt, but most lobbyists, Mr. Warner, are not attorneys. So you're imposing an entirely new timekeeping requirement on the vast majority of lobbying entities who don't bill their time.
Mr. Tarzi, how do the lobbying disclosures, I mean, so
I
am used to billing my time.
Right, but I can also tell you that as an employee of an organization, I usually tell my boss also who I met with and when I met with them as well. So you usually are keeping track, whether it's scheduling those meetings. We're talking, it's important to realize we're talking about very specific instances, and in those specific instances, I haven't had lunch yet. Those few instances would require you to keep track, but again, it's only there's a substantive conversation happening where you're truly attempting to influence. So if you are for example, a lobbyist with a lot of, you know, recognition, you know everyone in the city, that 3 minute conversation can probably accomplish a lot more than probably a lower level lobbyist who has a half hour conversation or hour conversation, because you have maybe been in the industry for 20, 25 years. You have those serious, credentials where a city official is more inclined to hear you for those 1 or 2 minutes. But again, if it's just a high buy, as Commissioner Murray mentioned, that's not what we're tracking. We're tracking that substantive influence.
Can you answer the question of, and I'm sorry if you just did my point, but the issue of if lobbyists aren't billing their time by, you know, if like the 3 minute, I mean, for, I would not have billed for 3 minutes if I saw a client. But how does it work with respect to lobbyists and their time?
Sure, generally, because we're looking for the date, they would, of course, schedule the meeting, so there is a record of them scheduling the meeting. For those specific instances where they're meeting someone, that's something they would go back and log, I'm assuming, or be part of a longer communication, because you usually don't have one-off communications with a city official. So if you are discussing at this infamous snack stand a particular issue, there's more, most likely going to be a follow-up conversation, either that same day or by email or a few days later or next week, practically speaking. So you're going to have some sense of when that communication happened, even if you're not billing the client, if you're part of an organization.
But how are they billing if they're not billing?
No, I'm saying even if you're you're a lobbyist part of an organization, you're not if you're not billing, you still have that track record of communication with the city official.
We don't ask for the billing agreements or contracts of lobbyists and their clients. I mean, I think that would be maybe perhaps overreach in some.
No, I understand that nobody wants to, but what do most of those agreements look like? Do we know? Just anecdotally, like, we don't know.
Just you're saying some of them are monthly billing, some of them are yearly billing, or
so it's $10,000 every month, and if you talk to someone for 3 minutes,
and we expect X amount of hours, and I would think if I were paying my $10,000 that month as a client, I would like to see something other than it's January, $10,000. I think I'd like to see what you were doing?
Yeah, whatever is disclosed by the regulated community, I always tell them when they have questions, what number am I supposed to put here? I said, well, I'm not privy to your business organization and how it works, but whatever you put down, should there ever be an investigation, very simply, you need to be able to substantiate this to our enforcement division, and however you provide that backup, whatever materials you use, whether it's timesheets, whether it's calendars, whatever you can use to provide us with some reasonable sort of way that we can in fact say, oh yes, this does coincide with what you're disclosing, that's fair to us. Best faith ever. I hope that's helpful.
Any other questions?
Yes.
I think Commissioner Murray asked about what you just said, literally the last thing you just said, Mr. Lowe, is the best faith effort, right? And to your point, Mr. Tarza, we're not nickel and diming that, if you're recounting that you had, a conversation on said date, that nobody's gonna punish you if you don't report a third or a fourth date out of
out of pure forgetting, right? That the point is that the interactions are happening on an ongoing basis and to get the gist, right?
Correct, yes.
Can I ask to take stock of where we are in terms of our comfort in approving, not approving?
I am closer to approving the ordinance, the direct commission ordinance as written. I don't have an opinion one way or the other, or a formed opinion, I should say, as far as the date.
Let me ask this. Does there seem to be consensus on other parts? What about the other part really is the exemption, the 501c3 exemption. Because it seems to me that perhaps, so there's five areas that we're really concerned about, and I think that we have consensus on three for sure. Direct communication seems to be the most difficult, and the 501c3 exemption, I know there's two of us who are comfortable, and I'm wondering if we could get to a place where we approve four of the five and give very, or maybe we would approve all, but if we don't approve direct communications now, give very narrow and detailed comments as to exactly what we might want to look for that would be different and not once again reopen all of this. So I think we should talk about where we are with respect to the exemption, the 501c3 exemption.
So I, in its current state, would not support the exemption. I do have some specific feedback about how I would like to see it modified or broadened. I think, in addition to, so keeping the language in the